It's over a year and a half since this moment of history on the 25th of January 2011. Something most Egyptians thought they would never see. And yet, there still remains a discontent on Egypt's streets. A discontent about Egypt's stolen billions.
You want to go to your bank account, $100 million, and put them in a bag, and you go out of the bag from the Qahira, no one will tell you anything.
A dedicated team of BBC Arabic and British journalists have been working for many months trying to unpick the truth from the many rumors about Egypt's stolen billions. Our journey leads us to the financial centers in Britain and Switzerland and back from where it left, Egypt. On our journey, we discovered accusations and rebuttals.
الأموال دي موجودة في بريطانيا والحكومة البريطانية بتخفيها.
At the moment, we are cooperating as best we can with the Egyptian authorities in trying to return the money.
Defenses and condemnations.
ما عنديش لأن أنا I wasn't the fundraiser. I'm getting very nervous now.
حتى الآن لا توجد إرادة سياسية في الدولة المصرية لاستعادة الأموال المهربة.
And also revelations.
About the amount of money frozen in the Egypt case. We have a little bit more than 700 million Swiss francs which are frozen.
The BBC goes after Egypt's money and asks if Egyptians will ever see it back again.
هناك مقولة شائعة مفادها أن مصر هي أغنى دولة في العالم لأنها تنهب منذ عصر الفراعنة. ويبدو أن الأمر لم يختلف كثيرا اليوم. فهناك مصادر مقربة من البنك الدولي تقول إن حوالي 54 مليار دولار لم يستدل عليها خلال الثماني سنوات الأخيرة. قبل الثورة الكثير من المصريين كانوا مقتنعين بأنهم لن يروا هذه الأموال أبدا. أما بعد الثورة فهم يسألون عن هذه الأموال ويريدون استردادها.
These are well-known faces in the Egyptian political and business elite from the Mubarak era. On March 21, 2011, 30 days after Mubarak fell from power, all 27 EU foreign ministers, under the lead of Foreign Policy Chief Catherine Ashton, agreed to the freezing of all these people's accounts under the suspicion that they may have been involved in Egypt's stolen billions.
كتير مليونات مليارات
للأسف مش متأكد يعني ما فيش حاجة تبقى مؤكدة يعني إذا كانت مؤكدة فأنا بقول لحضرتك إن هترجع الأموال دي لمصر
يعني هل تعتقد أن هذه الأموال ستعود فعلا؟
هو والدي بيقول لي أعتقد أنا ما أعتقدش إنها ترجع بس هي يا ريت ترجع لو رجعت زي ما قلت لحضرتك اقتصاد مصر هيعلى جامد وهنعمل حاجة والشعب المصري هيعيش
The World Bank estimates that the theft of public assets across the world is between $1 and $1.6 trillion every year. What about the amount missing from Egypt? Experts that the World Bank consults have accounted for $134.4 billion of public assets going missing over 30 years. That is a total of around 817 billion Egyptian pounds. The BBC has seen documents in London, Switzerland, and Cairo that appear to show how Egyptian state assets were plundered by its rich, privileged business and governmental elite during the three-decade rule of Hosni Mubarak. For this special investigation, the BBC has traveled to the European centers of global capital, where wealthy Egyptians are known to escape the harsh Egyptian summer and bathe in the luxury of the Swiss mountain air.
أهلا بكم إلى سويسرا، ذلك البلد الهادئ الغني في وسط أوروبا، المعروف بالشوكولاتة وبمصاريفه وبساعاته الدقيقة أيضا. وهنا في سويسرا يأتي الكثير من أثرياء المصريين لإنفاق أموالهم ولإيداعها أيضا. أنا ذاهب الآن لمقابلة المدعي العام المسؤول عن تجميد هذه الأموال.
About the amount of money frozen in the Egypt case, we have a little bit more than 700 million Swiss francs which are frozen under our own domestic investigation. How far we are? We are 1.5 years after the first request of mutual legal assistance, more or less. So I think we are quite early in such a huge investigation. We have more than 20 people, police officers, investigators, analysts, prosecutors, to deal with the investigation, to speed up as quickly as you can.
The BBC wanted to deliver this information to the Egyptian people and Councillor Asim Al-Gohari, the man in charge of finding Egypt's stolen billions at the Egyptian Ministry of Justice. He agreed to give his first interview since the revolution. We broke the news to him that the Swiss have frozen over 700 million Swiss francs, about 4.2 billion Egyptian pounds so far.
أول حقيقة أنا سعيد جدا بهذا الخبر طبعا وأعتقد أن الشعب لو علم بهذا سوف يكون أسعد أيضا فشكرا على هذه البشرة الجميلة.
Mr. Asim Al-Gohari has been a criminal judge for 37 years in Egypt and is in charge of submitting mutual legal assistance requests or MLAs to countries where they suspect Egyptian money has been stashed. These requests enable an exchange of information between the country from which the money left to the countries that received them in the prospect of officially asking its return.
بعد الثورة مباشرة تلقينا بلاغات كثيرة جدا بالنسبة للمسؤولين وبالنسبة لمبارك بالنسبة للفساد ولكن نما إلى علمنا من البلاغات المقدمة أن هناك أموال موجودة في الخارج الأسرة الحاكمة استمرت فترة طويلة مدة 30 سنة وهي أسرة فاسدة وبالتالي فالفساد متجذر وبالتالي متجذر في كل المؤسسات يعني ما نقول فساد مؤسسي في الكل الحقيقة صرحت النيابة العامة مباشرة بطلب مساعدة إرسال طلبات مساعدة قضائية إلى كل دول العالم في شهر فبراير أي بعد أيام قليلة من الثورة
Egyptian money is reported to have gone as far as Riyadh, Doha, Dubai, Nicosia, London, Madrid, Panama, and Switzerland. And these places have reacted very differently to the requests from Judge Al-Gohari to assist in getting the money back to Egypt. Judge Al-Gohari claims the political will varies greatly in these different countries. And he says Switzerland is an example of positive response.
أنا هنا في مركز السلطة في العاصمة السويسرية بيرن. انظروا هنا مقر المصرف السويسري المركزي حيث تتقرر كل السياسات النقدية للبلاد وعلى بعد أمتار منه مقر الحكومة الفيدرالية. كثيرون يعتقدون بأن الأموال المصرية المودعة هنا لن تخرج أبداً من المصارف السويسرية ولكن السلطات هنا يقولون غير ذلك يقولون بأن سويسرا هي البلد الرائد في رد الأموال إلى بلادها الأصلية وأنا الآن متوجه إلى وزارة الخارجية للتحدث مع من يسمى هنا بالأب الروحي لرد الأموال إلى أصحابها Ambassador Valentin Zelvega
is the director of international law department at the Swiss Foreign Ministry. He's the one who published a list of names belonging to the former regime only half an hour after Mubarak's resignation was announced.
سويسرا هي أول البلاد التي قامت بهذه الخطوة في هذا التوقيت.
By the time of the announcement, of course, the list was ready. It's a list of people who were suspected of wrongdoings. Of course, in each and every case, it will have to be proven that the assets that may be in Switzerland were the fruit of illicit behavior, be it that they were embezzled, that they were stolen, or in other ways gotten in an illicit manner.
الكثير من المصريين يتساءلون لماذا أخذت سويسرا هذه المبادرة ويقولون أليس من الأبدى أو الأجدر أن نأخذ نحن هذه المبادرة؟
Of course, Egypt can do it itself, but there is a lot of specific knowledge that you have to have and at which we are very good. You need to build a partnership, and that's important. It's not just about, you know, receiving requests from the other country and then saying, well, this is fine or it's not fine, but it's trying to build a partnership that allows you to pick up the phone and then to discuss how you will go about what exactly is the kind of information that you need. But what we wish to do is to show the concerned countries that by working actively together, we are both in a position then to send back the money as quickly as possible.
I asked the ambassador, what impact does losing this money have?
Well, the World Bank estimates that per year between 20 to 40 billion US dollars are stolen and are sent to financial centers across the world. Now, as you see from an estimation, 20 to 40 billion, that is probably not very precise, but it gives you the scale of the problem. And the 20 to 40 billion that are stolen are 20 to 40 billion less for development. And 20 to 40 billion US dollars correspond roughly to 20 to 40% of overseas development assistance that is given all over the world. So you see the size of the problem.
One doesn't need to spend long in Cairo to get a clear reminder of the destitution and poverty that afflicts Egypt still. The World Bank estimates that around a quarter of the population live with less than $2 a day. The hopes of generations of Egyptians for a better life is being crushed on a daily basis. Just because this money has been frozen does not mean Egypt will ever see it again. The money can be frozen through these MLA requests from Egypt, but only if Egypt can assist in providing evidence of its illicit origin. And that's the difficult part. The Swiss Prosecutor General's office have been trying to make this operation of sharing information and completing MLA requests easier by supporting an adaptation of Swiss law that gives criminal status to a mafia regime or a state. A Swiss court ruling announced in May 2012 that former Egyptian regime was to be given this organized crime status. Once this status is established, the Swiss can apply a different legal status to Egypt through what is called reversing the burden of proof. In other words, you are no longer innocent before proven guilty. You are guilty before proven innocent, as the Swiss Prosecutor General explained to me.
The existence of an organized crime group, all the money involved, the relations involved in the investigation for this group are seen illicit. So they have to prove that the origin of the money is not illicit. That's the reverse of the burden of the proof.
So while a country such as Switzerland is trying to find Egypt's money by changing the legal status of the former Egyptian regime through Swiss law, the information to find and return the money still needs to originate in Egypt.
Thank you.
منذ اندلاع الثورة لم تنقطع البلاغات الخاصة بفساد المرحلة السابقة، وانتشرت مئات الإشاعات ونظريات المؤامرة، وطبعاً من الصعب التحقق من صحة كل هذه المعلومات. لذلك أتيت إلى هنا إلى مصر إلى مصدر الأموال التي تم تهريبها لأقابل الأطراف التي تحقق في غسيل الأموال وتهريبها إلى الخارج.
After the revolution, there have been some Egyptians who have decided not to trust what their government tells them about Egypt's stolen billions, and they have started their own investigations. Public investigators like Dr. Mohamed Mahsoub, who I met in his office in Cairo. Dr. Mahsoub was one of the founding members of the Civilian Restitution of Assets Committee that started to look for Egypt's stolen money even before President Mubarak stepped down.
عملنا ايميل على الانترنت باسم المجموعه، اصدرنا البيان الاول على الفيسبوك، وقلنا من لدي اي اسرار متعلقه او بيانات او معلومات متعلقه باموال مصريه مهربه الى الخارج يوافينا بها على العناوين الالكترونيه اللي اشرنا اليها. اليوم التالي يوم 9 كنا جات لنا ما لا يقل عن 600 مستند، في اغلبهم هم المستندات الجوهرية اللي بتقوم عليهم عملية تحقيق استرداد الثروة من خارج مصر والفساد الداخلي اللي حصل في مصر. أغلبها كان سليم باعتبار أنه ما حدش لحق فابريك، كان النظام ما زال قائم. الموقع ده اتضرب قبل ما ناخد كل المستندات دي، وتدخلت أمن الدولة وبوظت الموقع. فاحنا عملنا إيه؟ عملنا موقع جديد أو عملنا عناوين إلكترونية جديدة، ندعينا الناس تاني من خلال الميديا أن يرسلوا. فجت لنا ألافات المراسلات، منها زي ما بقول لك 600 رسالة، 600 مستند اللي هم بيمثلوا المستندات اللي بتعتمد على كل المحاكمات اللي بتجري في مصر حاليا بتستند إلى هذه المستندات.
طيب بعد عام ونصف من الثورة، هل تعتقدون أن هناك إرادة سياسية موحدة لاسترداد الأموال التي هربت إلى الخارج؟
حتى الآن لا توجد إرادة سياسية في الدولة المصرية لاستعادة الأموال المهربة. التفسير الحقيقي أنه مفاصل الدولة المصرية لم تسقط مع سقوط رأس النظام، وبالتالي كانت تحمي نفسها، تحمي الغير حماية لنفسها.
في رأيكم ما الذي يمكن أن تفعله بريطانيا لتغيير موقفها؟
بريطانيا هي تقف في الجانب، في جانب الدول الأكثر سوءا في هذا الملف. لا توجد إرادة عند الدولة المصرية في المرحلة المنتقلة، المرحلة الانتقالية، وده أمر متوقع في كل حالة انتقالية بعد أي ثورة. لكن الدول الأخرى المستقرة التي تلقت موجة الفساد، من المؤسف أنه أيضا لا توجد لديها أي إرادة سياسية لرد هذه الأموال، ربما لمصالح اقتصادية لكنها مصالح اقتصادية قصيرة.
The BBC has done its own research into the assets of these 19 people based in the UK. And what we found was very concerning. The BBC found evidence suggesting that the UK has not performed basic checks on public companies and properties in the UK. The BBC found companies and assets in the UK that appear to have clear connections to people on the list and yet were not frozen. For example, 28 Wilton Place, the residence of Gamal Mubarak, a mansion block in Knightsbridge, just around the corner from Harrods. In this neighborhood, the cost of the house would be somewhere between 8 and 10 million British pounds. The document in our possession clearly establishes the connection between this house and Gamal Mubarak. The land registry title shows that the property officially belongs to a firm in the tax haven of Panama. And this may be the reason why there is no reference on the land registry to any freezing orders. To get a second opinion on these documents, my colleague Tim Hewell from BBC English Newsnight program, working with me on this investigation, took it to an assets recovery solicitor in the City of London.
Okay. Well, this morning you sent me a copy of part of the annual return of this company, Medinvest Associates. And we discovered that one of the directors of that company was in fact Gamal Mubarak, living at 28 Wilton Place. So, if you like, that's a fairly strong clue as to his connection with Wilton Place.
It's difficult to understand why the British government haven't found these documents when it took us a few minutes to find them publicly accessible on the internet. Or if they have found them, then why this isn't sufficient evidence to put a complete freeze on Wilton Place to find out if this Panama company is actually a cover for the assets of Gamal Mubarak. We also checked other less well-known names on the list, like Nagla El Ghazayerli. She's the wife of former minister Ahmed El Maghrabi, who is presently awaiting trial in Egypt for the misappropriation of public money and seizing state land. We found from the same company's house search that his wife had opened a company in the UK after the revolution in November 2011. The company's name is Essential Designs by Najla Limited and is registered in London, and there is no sign in company's house indicating that its operations had been restricted. And also, when checked on the land registry, it appeared that no freeze was put on that asset either. And Nagla Ghazayerli says the UK authorities are aware of her starting this company.
We've got here Ahmed El Maghrabi, who was the former Minister of Housing, and his wife, Nagla Abdullah El Ghazayerli. If we look at this company here, Najla Limited, and lo and behold, we have her name on the list, on the register, as the director, and an address in Chelsea, where she's operating from, presumably. We find, again, I think rather interestingly, that this company was authorised on the 1st of November last year, and the sanctions list was put out in March last year. So she has managed to form a company since the sanction list was put up. And so you wonder who is sort of keeping an eye on these things, if it hasn't been picked up that somebody who is subject to the sanctions has been able to form a company, register it in the English company's registry, and it's not, apparently, not subject to any sanctions. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, one wonders whether any questions were asked at the company's registry. Well, hang on a minute. You're on the sanctions list. What are you doing? Setting up a new company. What are you intending to do with it, etc.?
In Egypt, we showed Al-Ghohari the files showing that Egyptian assets belonging to some of the 19 names on the official frozen sanction list had not been frozen.
تبين من تعاملنا مع الحكومة البريطانية بخصوص طلبات المساعدة القضائية تبين أنها بتغلب القانون الداخلي في بريطانيا ولا تطبق الاتفاقية التي وقعت عليها لمكافحة الفساد. احنا هنا في مصر أموالنا موجودة في بريطانيا، طب كيف نحصل على تلك الأموال؟ هنحصل عليها إزاي إذا لم تقم بريطانيا لمساعدتنا للحصول عليها؟
It certainly seems from our evidence as though the UK has not done all it can to help Egypt return assets. So we put our evidence directly to the Foreign Office Minister of the British government. I started by asking the minister if he thought the British government had done everything it can to help Egypt trace and return stolen Egyptian assets in the UK.
Yes, I believe we have. To trace money, you need evidence of where the money is. That can often depend on intelligence. It may be difficult to find that in Egypt as well as in the United Kingdom. But the short answer is yes, we're very determined to do this.
ما هي الجهود التي تقوم بها بريطانيا لتعقب وتجميد الأموال المصرية في الخارج؟
We have provided help over the past year through our police, through our serious organised crime agency, to work with Egyptian authorities on identifying and tracing the assets. We have been proactive in trying to help the Egyptian authorities understand what they need to do to identify and find them.
أنتم تقولون إنكم تبذلون كل جهودكم لتعقب وتجميد الأموال المصرية في الخارج، ولكن بعملية بحث بسيطة في الوثائق العامة هنا في بريطانيا وجدنا أن هناك أرصدة تخص أشخاص في هذه القائمة التي أصدرتموها، وهؤلاء هم الأشخاص الذين قمتم بتجميد أموالهم. هذه الأرصدة لم تجمد، ما هو ردكم؟
Well, I'm not aware if any applications have been made to freeze any of these particular assets. You haven't given me any notice of these names, so I'm not in a position to answer that. In order for us to do our work, we need the information from the Egyptian authorities. If that has not been forthcoming, we've not been able to help.
وهذه الوثائق متوفرة لدى السجلات العامة وتخص السجلات المدنية وسجلات تسجيل الأراضي والممتلكات هنا في بريطانيا. إذا هي متوفرة بكل سهولة، وبالرغم من ذلك يبدو أنكم لم تجدوا هذه الوثائق.
So why haven't applications been made to freeze the assets by the people who wish to do so?
And yet, we have been told by the Egyptian authorities that they have sent the information relating to these cases.
وزارة الخارجية البريطانية بتفترض فينا إن إحنا عارفين هذه الأموال، ونحن لا نعرف هذه الأموال. يعني بتفترض فينا إن إحنا عارفين الأموال كام وكيفية خروجها. لا، ونحن لا نعلم أي شيء عن وقع هذه الأموال. الأموال دي موجودة في بريطانيا، والحكومة البريطانية بتخفيها وبتطلب مننا أن إحنا اللي نقول إيه الأموال. هي تقول لنا إيه هي الأموال، تقول لنا إيه الأموال اللي عندنا كذا وكذا، وإحنا من الممكن جدا أن إحنا علينا أن إحنا نثبت ونقول مدى مشروعية هذه الأموال.
Our BBC Arabic investigation team also couldn't understand why the British government waited for the EU decision to publish the sanctions list.
من المعروف أنه عندما تسقط الدكتاتوريات تختفي الأرصدة بسرعة شديدة، وإصدار بريطانيا لقائمة بالأرصدة التي يجب تجميدها بعد 37 يوما من سقوط نظام مبارك يتيح وقتا كافيا لهؤلاء لنقل أموالهم، أليس كذلك؟
Well, I cannot, without notice, give you an answer as to the 37 days discrepancy that you mentioned. I have no knowledge of that.
It took Switzerland half an hour to freeze Egyptian assets, and they have frozen so far $730 million. It took the UK 37 days to wait for instructions from the EU, and they have frozen $134 million. This time lapse is clearly crucial to catching the assets and freezing them before they get moved. It seemed surprising that the Minister of Foreign Affairs, responsible for the Middle East, was not aware of this crucial information. And we asked the Shadow Minister of Justice in the UK what he thought of this.
He should be aware. I've raised it, and other MPs have raised this many times in the House of Commons, to correspondents, and I'm afraid we've got what I regard as rather complacent answers. I think the British could have acted even before the overthrow of Mubarak, when it was already clear that money and other goods were being taken out of the country. Indeed, that had been happening under the kleptocracy that was the Mubarak regime for years. But there is no excuse for not acting immediately. And as you say, the Swiss were able to act immediately. The British could have acted immediately. They have both the powers, and indeed, we are well geared up to freezing assets. We did it in the case of Libya. We've done it in the case of Syria. The question remains, why is Egypt in a different category?
تقولون في رسالة لكم، وأنا لدي نسخة منها هنا، بأن بريطانيا سوف تقدم كل ما في وسعها وسوف تتخذ إجراءات حاسمة وسريعة. ألا تعتقدون أنكم لم تقوموا بذلك؟
We freeze under notification given to us about money which should be frozen when proper processes have been gone through to give us the opportunity to do so. Of course, we want to make sure those processes are swift and correct, and we will continue to seek to do so. At the moment, we are cooperating as best we can with the Egyptian authorities in trying to return the money.
تقولون إنكم تساعدون الحكومة المصرية بكل الأدوات القانونية المتاحة لديكم، ولكن المصريين يرون الأمور بعين مختلفة. مثلا تحدثت إلى الأستاذ محمد محسوب وهو الآن يشغل منصبا وزاريا في الحكومة الجديدة، واعتبر أن بريطانيا هي حديقة الفساد للمصريين، هكذا تحدث عن بريطانيا، وقال أيضا إنه يعتبر أن بريطانيا شريكة للنظام القديم بسبب عدم تعاونها الكافي مع الحكومة المصرية. ما قولكم في ذلك؟
I'm not aware of any representation made by that minister to me or to the Foreign Office about the conduct of the British government.
So the Egyptians are saying that they are quite let down. They feel that they are let down by the British government, who's not actually honoring their promise to support the democratic process in Egypt. What do you say to them?
Well, this is a disappointing view. We're already the largest foreign direct investor in Egypt. We have £20 billion worth of company assets in Egypt.
We're talking specifically here about asset recovery.
Yeah, thank you. I'm talking about support to Egypt. You're putting to me that Egyptian people feel let down with the United Kingdom's support for the democratic processes. I'm telling you there's absolutely no base for that charge whatsoever.
From what you're saying, your support to the post-revolution Egypt is through investment and not through returning money or trying to trace this money and returning it to their rightful owners.
You're very good at spinning my words. What I was doing was setting in context the work that we're doing to support Egypt as well as asset recovery. I've already told you that it's a priority for us and we're working on it, and we've already accepted 17 applications for mutual legal assistance from Egypt, and we're working to recover money. But we have our processes to do so.
Having put this to the Egyptian authorities, they claim this is not the case, and the UK have only replied to 17 requests for assistance asking for more information. The Egyptians state emphatically that the UK has only received the MLAs but had not accepted them, because accepting them will mean submitting them to the next stage like the Swiss did. We had also been told about an important asset recovery meeting with Arab Spring states held in January 2012 that the Swiss authorities had hosted in Lausanne and invited the British to attend, and yet they sent nobody. I asked the British minister about the reason.
I'm not aware of why we didn't go to Lausanne. It's out of character with the rest of the work we've done on asset recovery. There is a meeting coming up in Doha which we are going to attend. I believe we're working as hard as we can in order to deliver the return of assets under our proper legal processes. If there are any direct complaints from the Egyptian government, I'm very happy to look at them, and we'll certainly look at a trade minister's concerns if the minister is still in place, would care to contact us about this.
The BBC will be very happy to provide you with these documents.
Oh, I'm sure you will.
If you need them.
Thank you very much.
Following this interview, the BBC submitted all the evidence it had found in the document to the British government. The British Foreign Office responded by saying, I quote, "We have passed all the information received from the BBC to relevant authorities. However, as we are unable to talk about individual cases, we cannot comment further." في رأيكم ما هي الرسالة التي تصل إلى المصريين من الموقف البريطاني؟
I think it sends a terrible message to the Egyptian people and the new Egyptian government that Britain is not interested in helping the Egyptian economy, in helping Egyptian society achieve justice. And it says how far we've sunk effectively in international estimation. You know, we used to be somewhere where international justice was done and could be seen to be done. And now we appear to be turning a blind eye to every type of abuse.
I showed the documents to one of the leading authorities on asset recovery, Professor Mark Beath. I asked him what his response would be to the fact that these assets had not been frozen.
Uh, Well, first of all, as a citizen, I would be outraged. But as a lawyer, I would say, well, it doesn't astonish me that much because I'm not sure that the rules on politically exposed persons, so-called PEPs, are really fully implemented in the UK. If you try to form a fair opinion, Egypt had a strong relationship to the West and quite a strong relationship to the UK for that. And I'm thinking especially also of all sorts of Arab banks with their subsidiaries in the City of London. If you go for a walk in the city, you can see them. I'm pretty sure that Egyptian crownies of the Mubarak family and members of that system felt quite comfortable also depositing money in the UK. That means that the banks really know with whom they are banking, whether they are really controlling, whether they are holding a company owned by a so-called politically exposed person, by a head of state or their closer family. Can I have my money back, can I have my money back, please, sir? Don't hear what you're saying, don't care what you're doing. Can I have my money back, money back, can I have my money back, please, sir?
مسؤولية استعادة الأموال المشتبه فيها لا تقع على عاتق الحكومة وحدها. فالمصارف التي تتلقى وتحتفظ بالأموال عليها أن تتحقق من مصدرها. ولكن تقريرا مستقلا صدر العام الماضي لحساب الحكومة البريطانية كشف أن 75% من المصارف الموجودة هنا في بريطانيا لم تتبع كل الإجراءات المطلوبة منها فيما يخص الأموال المشبوهة، مما يضعف كثيرا الأمل في استعادتها.
In the world market capitalist system, international finance has the privilege to jump across international boundaries every second, and this makes catching up with the money very difficult. This speed of financial transactions unfortunately favors the dictator that wants to hide his money. And if, as it seems, the banks are not doing the regulation they should, then it goes to somewhat explain why of the $1 trillion or more that goes missing each year has ever been returned to the country of origin. And of that $5 billion, $1.5 billion was returned from Switzerland alone. So does that make Switzerland the good guy for returning the dirty money, or the bad guy for having the dirty money in the first place? We met Renata Schwab from the Swiss Banking Association, who told us that banks have new reliable mechanisms of self-regulation for detecting corrupt monies.
They search immediately for such assets deposited either in the names of these persons or assets deposited in different names, but where these persons are beneficial owners. And then block the assets, of course, because the order says so. You have a specific form for these cases. It's called Form A, where the account owner, that means the one who opens the relationship, has to indicate the name, the address, nationality, birth date of the beneficial owner to whom the assets belong. And this form forms part of the whole client file that is deposited with the bank.
ماذا يحدث إذن لو كان هذا الشخص يكذب ولا يقول الحقيقة؟
You will see from transaction monitoring later on. You open the relationship, you take this form, and you will see from incoming funds that what the person told you, what the account opener told you, cannot be correct. And then to the parties involved in that specific relationship. And if you can't come to an end, if you can't set things straight, you have to break up the relationship.
إذن في هذه الحالة هل تنتهي العلاقة بين المصرف والعميل؟
Yeah, sure, all the time. All the time.
ولكن بما أن المصارف السويسرية جمدت ملايين الفرنكات السويسرية، هذا يعني بأن تلك المصارف لم تفعل ما كان مفترضا منها.
No, look, I mean, you are allowed to maintain relationships with politically exposed persons. Had a bank known at the very beginning of a relationship that a politically exposed person is bringing in corrupt money. It wouldn't have been allowed to accept such a relationship, to open such a relationship. But, I mean, we are mixing up two different questions. The one question is when opening a relationship to a politically exposed person. What do you know at that stage? And what do you know at the later stage when the government comes up and says, this politically exposed person is now a dictator, is now no longer, we break up the relationship to this government, to this specific president of the government and so on. And then the banks have to do the same thing. That's the problem.
ولكن بالتأكيد الكثيرون بل الأغلبية يعرفون بأن مصر كانت ديكتاتورية منذ سنوات طويلة.
Politically exposed persons can have legal sources of income as well. They can have business activities, professional activities, and of course you are allowed to accept such money. You are not allowed to accept corrupt money. And as long as you have no suspicion that the politically exposed person is bringing in corrupt money, you can maintain such relationship.
So even Swiss banks seem to have difficulties distinguishing between legal and illegal forms of income coming from PEPs or politically exposed people, such as our 19 suspects. Renata Schwab suggested we contact some of the banks themselves to ask them to account for their new systems of self-regulation, like UBS, the biggest Swiss bank that has been accused of harboring Mubarak's money. تعرف المصارف السويسرية بأنها رقيبة على نفسها فيما يتعلق بالأرصدة الأجنبية. أردنا أن نعرف المزيد حول هذا النظام واتصلنا بمصرف UBS وهو أكبر مصرف في سويسرا وربما في العالم. ولكنهم في النهاية رفضوا التحدث إلينا تماما. في كثير من الحالات تتوقف الأرصدة في أكثر من محطة وتحت أكثر من مسمى إلى أن تصل إلى وجهتها النهائية. من تلك المحطات جزيرة قبرص القريبة من مصر والتي كانت تحيط نظامها المصرفي بسرية تامة إلى أن أجبرت على التخلي عن ذلك عام 2004 لدخولها الاتحاد الأوروبي. هذه الوثائق التي حصلت عليها في القاهرة والتي تخص المصرف المركزي القبرصي تفيد وجود شركات كانت تستخدم في قبرص لتحريك الأرصدة. والمفارقة هي أن كل ذلك كان يتم بشرعية تامة لأن أصحاب تلك الأرصدة كانوا قريبين من مراكز اتخاذ القرار في البلاد.
From the hundreds of documents sent to Dr. Mohammed Mahsoub anonymously by bank employees, he was able to give the BBC a unique insight into how money took flight out of Egypt.
من آليات إخراج الأموال إنه أنا تخصص لي قطعة أرض. تخصص لشخص أو راجل أعمال كبير خصصت له قطعة أرض لعمل مشروع سياحي. فبيقترض عليه قرض هائل من البنوك عشان يعمل المشروع السياحي. يوم هذا القرض يستخدم الجزء الأدنى منه إن استخدم في لعمل بنية تحتية للمشروع أو البدء في تجهيز المشروع ويبحث عن شريك آخر أو ما شابه أو يتعطل المشروع مش مشكلة. الجزء الأصلي من المال يحوله إلى الخارج خصوصا في ظل رقابة ضعيفة على عملية نقل الأموال يعني في بعض المصارف في الدولة المصرية يمكن أن تنقل من خلالها الأموال أيا كان حجمها دون حتى أن يعلم البنك المركزي زي المصرف العربي الذي أنشئ باتفاقية معينة ولا يخضع لرقابة ولا لأساليب عمل البنك المركزي وبالتالي يعني آليات نقل الأموال إلى الخارج كانت سهلة جدا نتحدث النهاردة عن مثلا تريليون دولار من الأموال المصرية على مدار 25 سنة خرجت من الأراضي المصرية احنا خلي بالك لما نتكلم عن 220 مليار دولار منهوبة هي منهوبة بطرق جنائية لكن إذا تحدثت عن الطرق اللي هي القانونية لكنها ضد مصلحة المجتمع لكنها قانونية في نهاية ولا تمثل جريمة فاحنا بنتكلم فوق التريليون
It's very difficult to corroborate the statement from Dr. Mahsoub, but it does seem that a banking system was set up to facilitate the movement of money out of Egypt. Ashraf Rida is a disillusioned Egyptian banker who became sick of the levels of corruption as working as a general manager in the internal audit section of the Central Bank of Egypt. He spoke exclusively to the BBC from his home in Cairo.
فساد مقنن. اوكي. تم تغيير قانون البنوك سنة 2003 والأول مرة أصبح لرئيس الجمهورية محمد حسني مبارك الحق في تعيين محافظ البنك المركزي بصفة شخصية ومباشرة بدون أي مساءلات. طبعا اللي ينظر في تاريخ المحافظ البنك المركزي الدكتور فاروق العودة لأن ما فيش تسلسل وظيفي يبرر اختياره كمحافظ. تاريخه قبل كده ما كانش فيه أي منصب كبير يقول إن ده واحد تسلسل قيادي مصرفي رجل خبرة عظيمة يقود منه. لكن بما إن الاختيار جاي من رئيس الجمهورية ده اللي كان ماشي. وفي نفس الوقت برضو رئيس الجمهورية هو اللي اختار النائب العام ورئيس الجهاز المركزي المحاسبات اللي هو الجهاز الرقابي. فكده انت بقى عندك الجهاز المصرفي، الجهاز الرقابي، الجهاز التشريعي، قضائي من رئيس الجمهورية مباشرة.
The BBC has looked at documents available online that seem to substantiate what Ashraf Rida told me. We found a copy of the presidential decree number 64 of the year 2004 promulgating the statute of the Central Bank of Egypt. I quote, "The bank shall have a governor to be appointed by decree of the President of the Republic. The resignation of the governor shall be accepted by decree of the President of the Republic. The financial statements, the two auditors' reports, and the report on the financial position shall be submitted to the President of the Republic." We called Farouk Al-Uqda before broadcasting this program to give him the right to reply, but we haven't received any response. So these documents appear to confirm that this man, Dr. Farouk Al-Uqda, the Central Bank Governor, was appointed in December 2003 by the President's office. And guess who is still sitting there at the top of the Central Bank today? Do you know this lady? She left Egypt for Switzerland about 40 years ago. She has since been working with the World Health Organization and became Suzanne Mubarak's right-hand woman in Geneva. She kindly invited us into her apartment in Geneva with her two canine companions.
ببرامج تبع الصحة العالمية فكنا بنتكلم على كل الـ
موضوعات
دي عن طريق الإحصاء العالمي والمكتب الإقليمي فكان في كولابوريشن ما بين الاثنين واخد بالك فده اللي بدأ وبدأت علاقتي مع السيدة سوزان مبارك بالبرامج دي.
كان لك موقع بارز يعني في حركة المرأة الدولية من أجل السلام، يعني ماذا كان دورك فيها بالضبط؟ طب
cannot I cannot answer this in Arabic.
ما هو ماشي كويس.
لا مش ماشي قوي. لا
يعني دورك.
لا أنا عاوز أقول لك حاجة إن دلوقتي لما تطلع بن you have to stop it.
أنا كنت على التليفون.
I'm getting very nervous now. ما عنديش لأن أنا ما كنتش بعمل financing. فممكن تبص على الـ على الـ على الريبورت هتشوف الفانز جت منين ومين اللي ادى واللي اتصرف. ما عندي مش أنا. I wasn't a fundraiser.
We were interested in trying to get to the bottom of the rumors that abound in the Egyptian press about Suzanne Mubarak using her network of philanthropist friends and NGOs as a means to launder money.
$2,675 were transferred. There were donations given to the office in Cairo. And these were transferred to the Peace Institute. The Minister of Social Affairs that accepted, we we can do it. It's the minister. It's a legal way of doing it through the government itself.
Aliya Bindari certainly exhorts her innocence. And it's important to say that the BBC found no evidence to show that she was personally involved in any form of money laundering on behalf of Suzanne Mubarak. But in Cairo, we were given these letters marked highly confidential by an anonymous source confirming, as Aliya Bindari described to us, the movement of the assets from Suzanne Mubarak's International Women and Peace Movement to the Institute of Peace Studies at the Alexandria Library. This was in the end of 2011, a few months after the start of the revolution. And what was interesting was who had authorized this transfer. Look at the names. Egyptian Prosecutor General Mr. Abdel Majid Mahmoud, Dr. Najwa Hussein Khalil, Minister of Insurance and Social Affairs, Ambassador Ahmed Fathallah at the Egyptian Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ambassador Osama Shaltout, Head of the NGO Sector at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Dr. Ismail Siragiddin of the Alexandria Library. The BBC contacted all these people to get their response. Dr. Ismail Siragiddin and the Egyptian Prosecutor General, Mr. Abdel Majid, replied claiming that there was no reason to implicate the NGOs in any form of corruption or malpractice just because of the association with Suzanne Mubarak. Dr. Siragiddin added that the funds of the Peace Studies Institute will be transferred to the Central Bank of Egypt. And I quote, "It's a gift for the Egyptian people from the Alexandria Library." What level of guilt by association is required to condemn or even prosecute? The BBC has been told by a former symbol of the Mubarak regime how special arrangements were made between the Mubaraks and certain heads of Gulf states in return for tens of millions of dollars for Suzanne Mubarak's charities. And no doubt the Suzanne Mubarak International Movement for Peace benefited hugely in its fundraising from the association with the former First Lady. The disputed question is, does that make those funds corrupt by association? It does seem a fair question to ask why these people here were authorizing the movement of this $2.6 million without any question. And some argue there is an answer to this question by looking at the appointments of these people, like the Egyptian Prosecutor General, who approved of the transfer of the $2.6 million. He was appointed in December 2003 by this man, President Hosni Mubarak. Certainly, the likes of Dr. Mahsoub believe that these people and the funds are dirty by association and the funds should therefore be frozen for further investigation.
ندعو الجهات المصرية إلى التحقيق في هذا الأمر لكن في حاجة مهمة تشويه وجه الدولة المصرية الشعب المصري إن أنت تجمع باسم تبرعات هائلة ثم لا تستخدمها لصالح هذا الشعب المصري ولا توجد رقابة مصرية حقيقية الجمعية ليست مصرية وكان لها فرع في مصر أغلق هذا الفرع وتم تصفيته المهم عندنا ليس هذا المبلغ لديك وإنما تشويه الدولة المصرية وتشويه الشعب المصري وجمع تبرعات باسم الشعب المصري ثم عدم استخدامه على الأراضي المصرية ودون رقابة مصرية هذا هو الأمر الكارثي في الحقيقة
Questions certainly need to be asked as to why colossal fortunes in Egypt and abroad belonging to individuals who are not above suspicion haven't been frozen. Whatever the reasons, the deep transformation that shook Egypt and to which Egyptians now relate to will make them more resolute and persistent in asking for the return of Egypt's stolen billions.